thought it would be useful to tell you what I'm going to go through, right? Is this what was going to come to? I had a discussion with Hannah and Lorraine and Dawn about what I should cover today. And there's lots of people, as Lorraine's already said, there's going to be lots of people talking to you. And I guess my job is just about trying to kind of set the context a wee bit. So that's what I'm going to do over the next wee while. And I do think, I was actually thinking about it when I was asked to speak about participation, how nice it was to speak about something reasonably simple. Because we live in a language of jargon and acronyms, and with the language abounding, like, you know, sort of co-production, assets-based and so on. And actually participation, it's just about being involved in something. So while it sounds very simple, it is an absolute requirement for how we achieve better outcomes in Scotland. So it's good to be talking about that. So what I thought we'd cover today, what does it mean in practice? Why is it a good thing? Why are we talking about participation again today? Some of the kind of different levels of participation, the fit within our current policy landscape, and also some key learning that we're starting to gather along with partners in Scotland about what we need to do to try and increase participation and make it better quality. So that's what I'm going to cover. But before I do that, I thought it would be useful for you to start participating a wee bit first. These events are always good for meeting people you don't know, as well as kind of make, you know, make connections, as well as hearing what people have got to say. So it's important to use your voice too. So two things to do. First thing is, if you could go and find someone that you haven't met before and talk to them about an experience of your own participation. And I don't mean just going to work every day, right? But actually something that you participated in, either voluntarily because you've invited participate and tell them how you made it feel or how it made you feel about your partner. Okay, so just do a few minutes for that and try and, as I say, get someone you don't know. Does anyone share anything about that last exercise about feeling frustrated? Is there anything? Anyone share an example?
No,
too early. I know. You don't want to get into politics early on, but do you know what I mean? It's like, you know, we're going to get the outcome of an election today, do you know what I mean? Which I feel that none of us have the control over. And that's not a party political comment, it's a comment about democracy. But it's those kind of things that make you feel, do you know what I mean? My goodness, do you know what I mean? Things are out of control. Do you know what I mean? What can we do to try and shape and influence the kind of things that are going to happen in our lives from now on? Do you know what I mean? The way that it's been building up and so on. So for me, that's one of the big frustrations. And that's why we're going to talk about kind of different levels of participation as we go through today. But what about the good stuff? What about the positive experiences of participation? Does anyone want to share anything to do with that?
Well, I suppose, saying that in the comments, it wasn't about work stuff, it was about community stuff.
Yeah.
So, Tina mentioned that community cleanup, and I mentioned part one about thinking of people coming together for a common good, and you can't participate in a very active way, or you can just turn up and do something anonymously or back, you know, so there's all different roles.
And how did that make you feel?
I mean, for myself, I enjoy traveling and talking to people, but I know people just come up and do it. They don't talk to everybody and feel like they have the same age. I come to finish a 5K run. However fast, however slow people want to do it,
yeah.
So they do it. So, yeah. You know, of course, I feel a bit about it.
But the chances are they went away feeling as if they'd accomplished something, feeling good about something and so on. So yeah, like, so thank you for that. Thanks for that. And you've kind of spoken to that slide, do you know, in terms of where people all come together. That's kind of really good stuff. I mean, basically, I was had to speak at a conference outside Scotland just recently, and it's always a good thing to do because it forces you to think about the why. Do you mean, why are we doing what we do? Why are we talking about participation today? Because we're talking about it increasingly in Scotland. And quite often, I think, we don't think about the why, because you're so busy trying to focus in on what you've been asked to do, do you know what I mean, that it's difficult to kind of raise up and think, well, what are the kind of outcomes that we want to achieve, and actually, what are the ways of getting there? So from that point of view, it was useful for me to do that. But it's also fairly easy for me to talk about participation, because that's at the foundation of community development, which is what I've been involved in a personal and professional capacity for quite a lot of years, when I started. But I was counting up the other day, from when I started as a volunteer is nearly 40 years, so kind of in and out of communities in one role or another. Community development was always not just about bringing people together to do some nice stuff. It was always about doing that, yes, and kind of supporting communities to mobilise and organise around kind of basic needs. But it was also about, kind of, and it is also about trying to promote people to get engaged in democracy, to actually go forward into places and processes where they can try and influence change and structural change, not just this change in their communities. So in community development, we cover a whole spectrum of participation, but not everybody does, but we can do bits of it, and there are lots of different bits in the spectrum. So basically, why are we talking about it today? I don't want to go over old grounds in terms of all the policy stuff, because we know that we've been talking about this stuff for a long time, particularly since Christie. But we know that basically the services that we've got are unsustainable. We know we need to think about trying to reshape the relationship between the cities and the state. We need to work better with our people and communities. These are our assets. We can't keep fixing things. We know that public services often, do you know what I mean, in the past calculations have been made that we could pay 40% of our public money in failure demand, fixing the problems that could have been fixed early on. You know, so from that point of view, we're well aware of the policy landscape for this. But also, not just in the policy landscape, we know on a personal level that participation is good for us. We know that when people get the opportunity to participate, that they do come away feeling better about themselves. It's an opportunity for people to give a contribution to something bigger than them, and it's somewhere, it's a process where they start to get skin in the game, do you know? If people are sitting there not participating, then you know, you're very isolated, whereas when you get involved in stuff, you have a stake, it's an opportunity to give value and be valued. So on a personal level, it's really important. And basically, I can use this slide. This is my mum and dad, that's as big as I'm Do you know what, people know Aunt and Dec, you know Aunt Dec. Yeah. I didn't know that Aunt Dec stood in alphabetical order until last year. It's always Aunt and Dec, so if you never know which one it is, you know now. That's the biggest takeaway from today. But my mum and dad used to do the same app changing, right, so always in alphabetical order. But basically, I think my dad was at the kind of last bit of the war. And after that, and even before that, you know, he was just a man that wanted to be useful. And as soon as he couldn't be useful, his mental health was hellish. And that happens to lots of us. That was what he did. And he was lucky enough to work all his life and go into retirement. Was then unlucky enough to then have a stroke and have to go into a care setting. And both of my parents went into a care setting. And when you go into that kind of setting, your agency is stripped away from because you're too busy getting looked after. So on a personal level, do you know what I mean, these things can affect us all. So that leads me into thinking about, well, how do we design public services? How do we design public participation into services right across the policy spectrum? Not just care, but in health, community safety, and housing, and so on. Can you know where that is? It's quite hard to tell. It could be any peripheral housing estate, just about anywhere. That's what happens when you don't design participation into public services. It's somewhere in Dundee, actually, and it's also in a reasonably nice place, talking about that's like a grey, miserable day. But if you'd asked the people who were going to live there, do you think that's what they would have chosen? Or would they have chosen something where they had places to play, nice places to go and so on? So from that point of view, there's dangers in not designing participation into public services. I was also, this might seem a wee bit random, but I've been going through Desert Island Discs back catalogue on my train journeys because I live in the Ayrshire and I'm coming in out of Glasgow. And there's some great ones there, but I came up to it. And do you know who that is? Yeah, see the older folk. That's Billy Goulding. She was in the famous Battle of the Sexes, has spent a lifetime actually around equalities and so on. But basically, she was talking about in her Desert Island Discs about the fact that she's gay and she was a women tennis player, they were getting less money for playing tennis than males were and so on. And basically she was talking about dominant groups and non-dominant groups. And she was saying that the non-dominant groups, i.e. people who are quite marginalised, know what goes on in the dominant group's life because that's across all of our media. We know how they live. But the people who live in the dominant groups often don't know how people in the non-dominant groups live. So how dare we design services that impact on people without involving that in some way, at some level? Okay? So, this next slide is, I got me a bit of fright actually when Hannah said to me, I might have to take these slides out because I'm pinched that, it could well be copyrighted. And I know that it's quite far away from you. But essentially this gives kind of like a whole load of areas of different elements of participation, starting from individual to community to organised and institutional. Right, so we volunteer, or we become involved in community action, we become involved in community life, right up to the structural stuff, like citizens' duties, petitions, mobilisation, campaigns. I mean, so there are umpteen different kinds of participation, but they're all necessary. And they all need that foundation of communities. You know that first slide where people are organised, they've got places to meet, places to go and interact. That's where it all has to start from. And actually, Scottish policy is pretty good in just about all of these things, in terms of providing support and space and an arena for some of that kind of stuff to flourish. So, I thought we'd go back in time a wee bit in terms of policy, and I thought I would talk a wee bit about this. People here familiar with the National Standards for Community Engagement? Yeah? People generally are, right? And they kind of, when you talk about the National Standards, we know the National Standards are here. But I worry that they become a wee bit of the same wisdom that in Scotland we think we're great at community engagement because we've got the National Standards. And then you say to people, well, how do you use them again? Oh, man, we can look at them and they would say, that's what I've heard. A lot of people do use them. But anyway, they were quite an important bit of Scottish policy, the formation of Scottish policy around better community engagement. The original National Standards were launched in 2005, and then they were refreshed in the run-up to the Community Empowerment Bill, Community Empowerment Act in 2015, and they do sit within a whole load of policy areas that you might not even expect, you know, things like planning and so on. But basically, the good thing about the National Standards was the process behind them. They weren't written in a room by people like me or Lorraine or Doreen or anybody like that. They went through a participatory process, 2 years, working with 600 people who were involved in community life. So people who were activists in community planning partnerships, community representations, and professionals, and people who generally worked in communities. And because of that, there was a buy-in for them when they first kind of came onto the scene. So people knew what they were about. But that was quite important, and that was, as I say now, that was 2003. That's how many years ago is that now? About 16? Okay. Long enough ago, so they have been talking about this for quite a long time. And we also have got things like the Community Empowerment Scotland Act. As I say, I don't want, this could take a long time coming through, so I'm not going to talk about Community Empowerment Scotland Act. But more recently, we've had participatory budgeting come along in Scotland. People have been involved in PB at all. Yeah, do you like it?
Critical friends.
Good. Always good to be critical. There's PB and there's good PB. Right? So basically, when participatory budgeting is done properly, when it's transparent, when it's actually about people getting involved from the get-go about the kind of things that the budget could be spent on, and so on, and when it's inclusive, then it's good PB. And actually, we've been working quite a lot over the past few while in terms of developing this chapter for participatory budgeting. And it shows that we've got a lot of the same kind of principles within the National Standards. But essentially, this is about trying to make good PD happen, but it is fair and inclusive. It is properly participatory, i.e. people aren't just kind of invited in to make kind of like binary choices. Do you know what I mean? It's properly participatory. And it's deliberative. Now, we're not very good at deliberation yet in Scotland. We've got a long way to go. There's some opportunities coming up around the corner. It has to be genuinely transformational, and it has to be flexible and transparent. And actually, if it takes hold and it becomes part of our democracy, then that's something that we can really see trying to promote more participation in communities. Basically, we've signed, to date, the focus has been in small grants processes and participatory budgeting. But we do have a move towards a 1% mainstream commitment, where 1% of all local authority budgets, bar the you know, kind of local taxes, will get dispersed through PB. We're a wee bit far away from that yet, and we basically, the small grants model, in my view, shouldn't get thrown out, because actually we've seen lots of people in lots of places get involved that they have never before get involved in any kind of democratic processes. And they're coming out and saying, do you know what, I made a difference. And I made a difference because I know about this stuff. It wasn't stuff over here. I was voting things that are important to me and people in my communities, and that's the platform from which more participation can grow. So, we've got the PB stuff that's happening. So 6.4 million Scottish Government have actually put out so far in terms of promoting participatory budgeting in Scotland, so it's not insignificant. And basically, as I say, we've got lots of other things happening in Scotland about participation. We've got, I mean, again, I know Doreen's going to speak a wee bit about this, but we've got a local governance review taking place called Democracy Matters. Again, have folk heard about that? A series of conversations about where decisions should take place, at what level, and in whose terms, by whom. We've got a Citizens Assembly for Scotland, which Doreen again will probably speak about, but I'm really excited about a Citizens Assembly for Scotland. I'm really interested in what comes out of it, but I'm also really interested in it getting tested as a kind of proof of concept, because if this works, again, it can become part of democracy in Scotland. It's ambitious, and it has to be really big and robust, do you know what I mean? But it's a really interesting experiment for Scotland. And so we've got lots of things happening which we should be excited about, actually, lots of things to be positive about. I was down in Liverpool, actually, at the tail end of last week, speaking about participation, and the difference between what's happening down there and how out of control people feel compared to what we've got here in Scotland is immense. So we've got a lot to be positive about. But anyway, I thought I would conclude with a set of kind of learning so far. One of the biggest things is this: none of this stuff is going to happen overnight. Like, see the national standards, it was years ago, and did they actually work there and then? I'm not sure. But what they did do was provide a nudge in the right direction. And with a critical mass of lots of things happening with legislative levers like the Community Empowerment Act, all participatory budgeting and so on, we're starting to kind of nudge towards a much better kind of framework for participation in Scotland. But it's a long game, and we need to stick with it. We're dead good at chasing short-term initiatives in Scotland. We've really got to stick with this stuff, and we've got to include communities in it, and we can't erode all that stuff that happens in communities, because that's the foundation of which good participation is built. We also need to maintain the capacity of the public sector to be able to respond appropriately to citizens' priorities, and to support the capacity of the public sector to make those spaces for dialogue, for participation, to then respond. Okay, so it's got to work both ways. We've got the tools. We don't need any more tools. Do you know what I mean? It's always the first thing people do is go and say, do you know what, we need to develop a framework for it, a tool for it. So that's actually the really easy bit. The difficult bit is using these tools to put the practice in place and having the will to actually do that. So again, we don't need to do more of that stuff. We can do it. We've got lots of tools. Critically, we need to build inequalities to new participatory processes from the get-go. Because if we don't, we're just going to replicate the same processes that we have, and it becomes an echo chamber of the existing democracy. Now, Glasgow Disability Alliance have done some fabulous work in terms of equalities work within the context of PB, about challenging that, about making sure that we reduce the barriers to participation at every step of the game. And the National Standards Centre to do that, the PB Charter helps you to do that. The other thing is that we can't just do participation or PB, particularly just in poor communities or in marginalised communities. That doesn't tackle inequalities. This isn't about making decisions in and between poorer communities, so-called poorer communities. It's not about kind of trade-offs within that small kind of sphere of society. This has to get bigger. It has to get bigger so that all of those agendas are on the table and deliberated, so that there's trade-off at a structural level, and so that there really is transformational change. Okay? So this needs everybody to be involved, and it needs proper dialogue, facilitation, and deliberation. As I say, we've not been particularly good at that, and that's something we need to get experience to do. And that's the thing, we haven't spoken to, been around some of the Citizens' Assembly stuff and heard people who were involved in the Constitutional Convention in Ireland and the Irish Citizens' Assembly. They were saying that gave us time to sit back and listen to evidence and debate and deliberate things that our politicians just don't have time to do. So from that point of view, again, that's where it needs to be, deliberation needs to be focused. And we need to stick with it. I was just saying to Claire kind of earlier on, there's still quite a small cohort, although Scotland's got a very sympathetic policy environment, still quite a small cohort of civil servants, practitioners, academics that are really interested in participating in democracy. And something new and shiny happens, we all run towards it. and you kind of leave the other stuff behind. So this needs a kind of critical mass of folk. This needs more folk doing this stuff and talking about it. Right? And it also needs us to stick with it. And do you remember when we all go towards the Citizens' Assembly because it's new and shiny, remember PB, remember all this other stuff. And we get asked to go to other countries all the time as well because they're jealous of what we do. So that extracts kind of a lot of the expertise and a lot of the advocates for this stuff. So again, we need coherence. And we do need coherence across all this range of things, because when you're at a practice level, you hear about things like local governance review, participatory budgeting, community empowerment, Citizens' Assembly. It's then difficult to think about how you put all these things, and you can pay attention to all these things at a local level. So we need some kind of coherent narrative around it, I would suggest. And the other thing is, again, just, so that wasn't a final slide, sorry, first slide. Very best news is that even though we've got all of these legislative levers, we don't actually need them. We can do this stuff independently. We can do it whatever we like, we don't need permission. It's embodied in Scottish policy, and it's within our gift to do it if we want to improve outcomes for people. And that's where democracy starts. It starts with people including us. The thing that I would finally conclude on is, when we do participation, it's important that there is somewhere for it to land. Again, going back to that community development bit about occupying that space between what happens in communities and what happens in public services, it's really important to maintain that ground. So when you're working with communities, you're looking back to kind of your own services and your own systems to see how receptive they are to that change. So that's where I'll leave it.